Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
And blessed be God, now and forever. Amen.
Almighty God, in whom your hearts are open, God is as known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse us also our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name. Through Christ our Lord.
A reading from the book of Judges. The Israelites again did what was evil in the sight of the Lord, after he had died. So the Lord sold them into the hand of King Jabin of Canaan, who reigned in Gezer. The commander of his army was Sisera, who lived in Perisheth-Hagoyim. Then the Israelites cried out to the Lord for help, for he had 900 chariots of iron, and had oppressed the Israelites cruelly 20 years. At that time, Deborah, a prophetess, wife of Lapidoth, was judging Israel. She used to sit under the palm of Deborah between Ramah and Bethel in the hill country of Ephraim, and the Israelites came up to her for judgment. She sent and summoned Barak, son of Abinoam, from Kedesh in Naphtali, and said to him, "The Lord, the God of Israel, commands you, go take position at Mount Tabor, bringing 10,000 from the tribe of Naphtali and the tribe of Zebulun. I will draw out Sisera, the general of Jabin's army, to meet you by the Wadi Kaishan, with his chariots and his troops, and I will give them into your hand." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. from the first book of Thessalonians. Now concerning the times and the seasons, brothers and sisters, you do not need to have anything written to you. For you yourselves know very well that the day of the Lord will come like a thief in the night. When they say there is peace and security, then sudden destruction will come upon them, as labor pains come upon a pregnant woman, and there will be no escape. But you, beloved, are not in darkness, for that day to surprise you like a thief. For you are all children of light and children of the day. We are not of the night or of darkness. So then let us not fall asleep as others do, but let us keep awake and be sober. For those who sleep, sleep at night, and those who are drunk, get drunk at night. But since we belong to the day, let us be sober and put on the breastplate of faith and love, and for a helmet, the hope of salvation. For God has destined us not for wrath, but for obtaining salvation through our Lord Jesus Christ, who died for us, so that whether we are awake or asleep, we may live with him. Therefore, encourage one another and build up each other, as indeed you are doing. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Matthew.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
Jesus said, "For it is as if a man going on a journey summoned his slaves and entrusted his property to them. To one he gave 5 talents, to another 2, to another 1, to each according to his ability. Then he went away. The one who had received the 5 talents went off at once and traded with them and made 5 more talents. In the same way, the one who had the 2 talents made 2 more talents. But the one who had received the 1 talent went off and dug a hole in the ground and hid his master's money. After a long time, the master of those slaves came and settled accounts with them. Then the one who had received the 5 talents came forward, bringing 5 more talents, saying, 'Master, you handed over to me 5 talents. See, I have made 5 more talents. His master said to him, "Well done, good and trustworthy slave. You have been trustworthy in a few things. I will put you in charge of many things. Enter into the joy of your master." And the one with the 2 talents also came forward, saying, "Master, you handed over to me 2 talents. See, I have made 2 more talents. His master said to him, "Well done, good and trustworthy slave. You have been trustworthy in a few things. I will put you in charge of many things. Enter into the joy of your master." Then the one who had received the 1 talent also came forward, saying, "Master, I knew that you were a harsh man, reaping where you did not sow, and gathering where you did not scatter seed. So I was afraid, and I went and hid your talent in the ground. Here you have what is yours." But his master replied, "You wicked and lazy slave, you knew, did you, that I reap where I did not sow and gather where I did not scatter? Then you ought to have invested my money with the bankers, and on my return I would have received what was my own with interest. So take the talent from him and give it to the one with the 10 talents. For to all those who have, more will be given, and they will have an abundance. But from those who have nothing, even what they have will be taken away. As for this worthless slave, throw him into the outer darkness, where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth." The Gospel of the Lord.
Today we continue our Stewardship Reflection Series, and this is the 4th and final of an installment, and today we will hear from our very own Dr. Rudolph.
The pandemic has had a major impact on where we live. trust in God, and He will see you through. Good morning to Father Raphiell, Deacon Derrick, Senior Warden Paulus, Pastor and Parishioners of St. Luke's Episcopal Church, and to our choristers. Good morning.
Good morning, St. Luke's.
To the parishioners of this parish, the members of the Standing Finance Committee, along with Father Raphiell, Senior Warden and Vestry members, would like to say thank you for your prayers and support of this parish through your giving of your time, talent, and treasure, especially during this pandemic. And as Deacon Derrick was reading the gospel, it is quite apropos for today. And I had no idea. Christian stewardship is a way of life, a life of accountability and responsibility, acknowledging God as creator and giver of all. Stewardship involves responsible management of our God-given resources of time, talent, and treasure. Stewards, as disciples of Jesus Christ, see themselves as caretakers of all of God's gifts. Gratitude for these gifts is expressed in prayer, worship, offering, and action by sharing our gifts of love for God and one another. Stewardship is based on the principles of the Old Testament and the teaching of Jesus. Stewardship is not just a program or a method of fundraising. It is a way of thanking God for all His blessings by returning a portion of our time, talent, and treasure, which we have received. Christian stewardship is a path to holiness. It makes us more Christ-like, who came not to serve, but not to be served, but to serve. It is a grateful awareness that all we have and we come freely from God. When we offer our lives back to God in love, He blesses that generosity 100-fold. None of us earned our life. None of us continues to earn our lives. All creation is a gift of God. None of us can earn that. And if we think that we have earned it, you've made a mistake. We underestimate what God has given us, the world itself, and all the blessings that are on our earth. God gave that to us. We never made it or earned it. And our individual lives are a gift. Our abilities and everything we have is a gift from God. From everyone who has been given much, much will be demanded. And from those who have been entrusted much, much will be asked. Luke chapter 12, verse 28. The idea to whom much is given, much will be required, is that we are held responsible for what we have. We are blessed with talent, wealth, knowledge, time, and the like. It is expected that we use these well to glorify God and benefit others. Stewardship in a pandemic. COVID-19 pandemic is changing the way the world interacts, and the world and the church is not immune to those changes. Amid social distancing and shelter-in-place orders and mask wearing, many churches have either canceled worship and are moved to a virtual form of worship. Pastors, priests, and other clergy are looking for creative ways to continue to worship in a quickly changing landscape. Churches are using all sorts of technology to streamline worship services, share daily prayers, and to convene corporately, even if it means being online. Deacon Derrick, with the Fresh Start Ministry, continues to support and care for the most vulnerable through the food pantry, feeding, and taking those who are homebound to doctor's appointment and helping wherever assistance is needed. She has been an amazing task at Fresh Start. And I've served on the Fresh Start board with her, and we have had our tit to tat about how Fresh Start to operate, but it's all for the vulnerable. It's all for the vulnerable. And Deacon Diana Derrick, thank you, and the volunteers and Doug, the vulnerable are the most vulnerable at this time. You have no idea. Financial stewardship in a pandemic. Many churches, to include St. Luke's, operates on a very thin margin with little to no reserve. Most churches are still heavily dependent on gifts that are made in an offering plate when they are physically in the church. According to the National Study of Congregation Economic Practices, 78% of gifts are given during worship service. So we count today maybe less than 30 people. So that's difficult for us, right, Pat? Mm-hmm. Annie? Churches live on thin margins are not going to be able to operate if they lose 70% of their revenue during this pandemic. So how is St. Luke's going to get through this pandemic crisis in order to sustain God's house? Now, before I answer that for you, we have a new rector, Father Raphiell. He's been here 1 year and about a couple of weeks, Father Raphiell. And let me tell you about Father Raphiell. He has come in, he's rolled up his sleeves, and he's gotten to work. And for that, we thank you, Father Raphiell. You don't know what he has done since he's arrived. He can tell you about this fiscal plan when some of you all are here and those who will watch later today on YouTube. He can tell you where the problems are in this fiscal plan, this church, this parish, and some of you all that have been here all these years don't know. And you know how I know? Because he and I have gone around this place many times. And Darnell, raise your hand, Darnell. There's Darnell. Paul. We've been around this place. And so, why is that important? Pat, take your iPad and point up to the, everybody look toward the narthex. Pat, point up. And what do you see? There you go. So I'm going to answer the question. So how is St. Luke going to get through this pandemic? Answer. The Finance Standing Committee, along with Father Raphiell and the Vestry, will be asking the parishioners to give more during this crisis. Most of the parishioners are not aware of the significant physical deterioration of the parish. Leaking roof, need interior painting, defective plumbing resulting in water leaks that's happened several times over the past few months. Mold and mildew behind the altar drape. So when Deacon is behind the altar, it exacerbates her breathing problem. So when she's coughing, that's what's happened when she's behind the altar. So what are we going to do? You know, I grew up in a little church called Mount Pisgah in Dixie. Born and raised in the AME church. And of course, I've been married for about 46, 47 years. And I subsequently transferred my membership from Mount Pisgah to St. Luke's, I think about 2002, 2003, call us. I asked my mother, I said, Mom, I said, now I'm 50-something years old, and been married at that time about 40 years. I said, Mom, can I transfer my membership to St. Luke's? And she said, Son, she said, that's your wife, that's your family, and that's your home church now. So I was happy, very happy. Now, let's talk a little bit more about how we're going to take care of God's house. Because God has been good to St. Luke's. God has been good to the parishioners of St. Luke's. we have and who we are and whose we are is that of God. Back in, was it April, Father, when you told us to read the book of Psalms? Was it about April? Father asked the parishioners to read the book of Psalms. And I did. And after reading the book of Psalms, I said, I'm going to start in the book of Genesis. And I started in the book of Genesis, and at this time I'm in the book of Esther now. And when you read God's words, when you read God's words, the Spirit comes on you. Now, I was born and raised the catechism, Sunday school, Bible study, but you don't always appreciate that in life. And God has been good to me. Amen. Aunts, sisters, and brothers, my mother had a high school education. And a grandmother next door. And she saw her daughter struggle to raise her 8 children. And if you don't know what it is to be hungry, then you don't know what it is to be hungry, if you've never been hungry. But God took care of my grandmother and took care of my mother. So we go on in life. I'm the youngest of 4 boys. My oldest brother's deceased. My older sister's deceased. And we struggle in life. But God was always there. We didn't know it. We may not have had what we wanted to eat, but God found a way to feed us. So we move on in life, finish high school, finish Airport High School, doing immigration, 69. Accepted to many schools around the country, but wasn't able to get a scholarship. So I'm telling you this because I'm going to come to a point, okay? Because I know some seniors, Dr. Rudy, okay? And his assets. But I'm going to share the story with you, okay? So when I finished up from high school in 1969, June 69, I was the first African-American to be an honor graduate in Lexington County. Went to Detroit, Michigan to work with my brother Wendell, who is now deceased. Came back home. And I was on my way to Midland Tech. I'd been accepted to 10 colleges in this country. Ohio State, Georgia Tech, USC, Clemson. But I had no money to go to those schools. I had no money at all. Father, please go. I'm comfortable. And when I came back home to start Midland Tech, I got a call from the late Mortimer Smith. Mortimer Smith was the mayor of Casey. Some of y'all may know him. May have known him. He was a judge in Lexington County. He was also the mayor of Casey at the time. And my mother said, Mortimer Smith has called you, Rudolph, and he wants to see you. Well, I heard my grandmother and mother talk about Mortimer Smith, but I didn't know him. And at the time that I was awarded the honor graduate status, African American Lexington County, it was in the local newspaper. It was on the headlines. So he called me up and asked me to come to his office. And he was right there on Knox Avenue Drive. So my mother's house was there by Pickett Park. We had no car, so I walked from Pickett Park down to Knox Avenue Drive. So he said, Rudolph, he said, I'm Waldo Smith, your grandmother, and I'm the best of friends. And Warren, where are you going to school? I said, I'm going to Midlands Tech. He said, well, why are you going to Midlands Tech? He said, you did well in high school. I said, Warren Smith, I am going to take my money that I work for during the summer. I'm going to put a roof on my mother's house. I'm going to paint my mother's house. And I'm going to get a used car, and I'm going to Midlands Tech. He said, I'll make a deal with you. You go to Carolina Clemson, and I will defray all your expenses. I said, well, Lawyer Smith, I said, let me ask you this question. I made $6,000 that summer in Detroit. He said, you keep it. So I said, I want to stay home with my mother. I don't want to stay on campus. He said, that's fine. And so I stayed with mom, caught the city bus from Casey down to the Capitol building. There's a hotel on the corner of Main and Jervis Street. Can't think of the name of the hotel. It's torn down now. And I used to get off the bus there and walk across the State House campus to Carolina. Fast forward 2 years later, my academic advisor, the late Ed Mercer, lived in Edenwood, and he would drop his kids off to St. Peter's Catholic Church. So he had to come right by my mother's house. So he would pick me up and all the little kids in the back, in the panel van, and then we'd drop them off at St. Peter's and then go to Carolina. Going to school. Finished Carolina, went back to Detroit to work for the summer. Come back, I had been accepted to medical school in Charleston. And so when we arrived in Charleston, Carlton had been married for not quite a year, what, 8 or 9 months? And so, my classmate Charles Wittenberg, who has visited St. Luke several times with his wife Tina. And we're in the financial aid office, and Ms. Bulges, she said, how are you fellas going to pay for school? I think I had about $300 in the checking account. We had about maybe $400 or $500. And she said, what are you all going to do? And I said, you all going to give us some money. She said, okay, we'll try to find some loan money for you fellas. She did. So we're in our first class. We're in cell biology. I'm going to fast forward. We're in cell biology in Baruch Auditorium on Calhoun Street. 165 in the class, and 9 of us were African American. There were no Asians, no Hispanics, no Latinos. 9 of us were African Americans. And the cell biology professor said, there are some of you all here that we don't want here, but we need the federal dollars. He didn't say it in Greek, Spanish, German. You knew exactly what he was saying. That you're not African Americans that are here. We don't want you here. This is in 1972. But we need the federal dollars. Look to the person to the left of you, and look to the person to the right of you, because 2 of y'all won't be here. And before the end of the first year, out of the 9 of us, 3 were gone. So for the first 2 years at MUSC, she'll tell you. So we graduate, get through fellowship, get through residency, and then I wanted to do a fellowship in hematology and oncology, so I wanted to go into the military, Brian, because the military healthcare system is the largest healthcare system in the world. So, Collis, my brother-in-law Curtis, who was living in New York at the time, I thought about going to NYU to do my fellowship there, but the little boy from Casey, I'm going to live in New York. So, I had an offer to Lebanon Army Medical Center in San Francisco, and when I arrived there, to make a long story short, the director of the program said that I've already given the position to another field officer coming in from Germany. Well, in the military, all the fellowship assignments are made out of Washington, D.C. He did not tell the commanding officer of AMED in Washington that he had signed the job to show fellowship to someone else. So Brian, Major Gandera was rifted, which means that he made no rank for the next several years. So Washington called me up and said, Dr. Wines, he said, we haven't heard from you. I said, well, the position was not awarded to me. He said, I gave you the position. I said, well, Major Gandera said otherwise. So Major Gandera was rifted in the military. So he said, okay, would you go to Brooke Army Medical Center in San Antonio? So that's how we got to San Antonio. And Rudy was about a year and a few months old. Meager means, but God saw us through. Got assigned to Eisenhower in Augusta. Got through my internal medicine boards. Got through my medical oncology boards. Came back to the medical school here in Columbia. And then went into private practice. 14 years solo practice. Went through three physicians who didn't want to work. So if you don't want to work, you're not going to work with Dr. Rudy. So here I am, struggling, solo practice, and it's very stressful on my marriage, our son, so that's why you didn't see me in church much during the 80s and 90s. So, Rudy's freshman year in Chicago, and I had requested to be off so I could be there on Parents' Day. And while we were there getting ready to go to Parents' Day the next morning, I got a call from the manager of the office saying that the physician who was to take a call with you decided not to take a call with you. So then I had to fly back home, not see Rudy start his freshman year, and the competing practice called me up and said, Rudy, you don't deserve that. Let's merge our practices. And we merged and formed South Carolina Oncology. See what God will do for you? See what God will do for you? That's what God will do for you. That's what He'll do. Recently, you received a letter on the 16th of October. And that letter spoke to the shortfall that we have in this church. Where you stood with your pledge obligation at that time, there were several categories, and you were asked to look at your pledge letter, where you stood with your tithing to the church, and see what you could do. If you were current, thank you. If you are not current, please try to come current. But do what God has asked you to do. So when you've gotten the pledge form, everybody's gotten this, please do not put down an amount that you know you can't honor. Please don't. Please don't do that. Because this church operates on what you commit to give, okay? So put down what you can give when you have gone to commune with God before you fill it out, okay? But just don't put a number down. In conclusion, God bless you. God will see us through this pandemic. Don't be consumed by the news and all that stuff. Pandemics and plagues and epidemics have been around since 400 BC, and they will continue to be around. Don't let fear drive your life. Now, of all the living things, they all have a brain. But God is something special with man. He gave him the brain to use and think. So practice safe distancing. Wear your mask. Be careful. Wash your hands. About midsummer, we have vaccines. We saw that coming. They said, well, how do we know that was coming and whatnot? The reason why we know that from a medical standpoint, because God put science here. God put science here. He put man here to be a physician. But look here, he did. Okay? But he wants us to use it rightly. So, well, how come we came up with the vaccine so fast and whatnot? The reason being is because there have been coronaviruses or SARS viruses back in the 2000s in the Middle East. Didn't bother us because we didn't know about it. So they were doing research on it then. A lot of the research on viruses came from the HIV. Came from HIV. The first case of HIV in the state of South Carolina was in 1984, a young gentleman from Greenville. He was brought to Richmond Memorial Hospital, and the late Dr. Jim McFarland and I had the privilege to be able to take care of him. A lot of the research on viruses was based on what we learned from HIV. All the different drugs and everything. So when research is done and it fails on the different infection and whatnot, those drugs are kept in a library for lack of a better reason. So fast forward, what happened in this illness, the computer goes back and researches all those drugs that have been used in other things. So that's how, through God's divine intervention, through God's divine intervention. But God said, you're in a pandemic. Now, I Googled and said, why did God put us in this pandemic? God didn't put us in this pandemic. He didn't put us in this pandemic. When we don't do things properly, and way in China, in those wet markets, where live animals are being slaughtered and processed from slaughterhouse to table, in this country we have the FDA, we have the Food and Drug Administration, we have the organization that protect us. But it can't protect us from the rest of the world, okay? And airplanes take us all over the world. Airplanes take us all over the world. So you've got somebody infected in Wuhan, China, that comes into New York, or that comes into the West Coast on that airplane, breathing the same air and whatnot. The first case was in Washington State and whatnot, but the first case wasn't in Washington State. We forgot about the people who've come in from China through New York and places like that. So it was already here. It was already here. So, keep your faith in God. Keep your hope in God. Keep your trust in God. And do not panic. God will get us through. He will get us through. Do not be consumed by all the noise, because it will only make you anxious, fearful, and depressed. And there's an old song that my grandmother used to sing, that used to be on the radio all the time, Miss Herbert. He may not come when you want him, but he's always on time. He's always on time. And to Father Raphaell and Senior Warden Carlos and Christian members and to the parishioners, thank you all so much.
All standing, please turn to page 358 in the book of common prayer for our faith. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God of God. Body and mind, true God, begotten and created, of one being with my Father, who knew all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary, and was made man. For our sins, he was crucified and punished with Pilate. He suffered death as a barrier. On the third day, he was born again. In accordance with the scriptures, he ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in the world to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord of the living life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he has worshipped and glorified. He has spoken to the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
I ask your prayers for God's people throughout the world, for Michael, our presiding bishop, for Andrew, our own bishop, for Raphaell, our rector, for Diana, our deacon, for this gathering and for all ministers and people. Pray for the church. I ask your prayers for peace, for goodwill among nations, and for the well-being of all people. Pray for justice and peace. I ask your prayers for the poor, the sick, the hungry, the oppressed, and those in prison. Pray for those in any need or trouble. I ask your prayers for all who seek God or a deeper knowledge of God. Pray that they may find and be found by Him. I ask your prayers for the departed, especially John Brown and Willa Martin Bailey, sister of Gerald Martin. Pray for those who have died. I ask your prayers for Charles, Eddie, Francis, Juanita, Dorothy, Levi, Carmen, Mildred, Cherish, Charles, Geneva, Gloria, for our healthcare workers, for those affected by COVID-19, for our president-elect. Are there others?
I ask your thanksgiving for this beautiful day, for our new choristers, for this holy place that is our worship home, for our families, friends, others. Praise God for those in every generation in whom Christ has been honored. Pray that we may have grace to glorify Christ in our own day.
Lord, hear the prayers of our people, and what we have asked faithfully, grant that we may obtain thankfully for the glory of thy name, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor.
Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you, in thought, word, and deed, and by what we have done, and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry and humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your name.
Amen.
Almighty God, have mercy on you, forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life.
Amen.
Please stand. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
Good morning.
Thank you all for being here today. Father Wise, thank you for those encouraging words for us as we conclude our stewardship campaign. Very timely words, and I had sort of read over the gospel lesson this morning, but since I didn't have to preach, I really didn't dwell into it. And I thought the gospel lesson, the message, and the sequence here all tied in very well together. I stand before you today because of faith as well. Some of you don't know, but last May, I was in a car accident, which could have prevented me from being your rector today, but through God's prayers, I was able to accept your call and make a life-changing move for myself to be here. We are here in church today because I have faith that we will keep everyone as safe as we can. We have our organist Tim here today because I have faith. We have our choristers here today because I have faith. We've been here every Sunday since late August because I have faith. And I know each person has their own safety level, safety comfortability as to when they feel like they want to come back to church, and that is fine. But as Dr. Rudy stated, I think sometimes we spend too much time glued to our television and not enough time glued on our knees in prayer. God, and for all the things that we have, and I'll stop preaching now, but my thing is, if we can go everywhere else that we want to go, then why is God's house always the last place that we want to come? Our annual meeting will be held next Sunday, November 22nd, in the gym. Now you might be thinking, is that a little nasty gym over there? But you can walk in there now, it is completely bare, and come Monday, the floor will be completely redone. So depending on how many people we have here, we will have chairs set up distance 6 feet apart for those of you that will stay for the annual meeting. If it's maybe this many people here, then we'll probably just go in the parish hall. More information will be forthcoming about that in the coming week. We also are in need of two persons to serve as delegates for the Midlands Convocation and as the Diocesan Annual Convention for a 3-year term. If that is something that interests you, please call the parish office and let myself or Cheryl know by this coming Wednesday. Now, I believe we have two birthdays today, James Copley and Russell Griffin, who I don't see here today, so let us wish them happy birthday in absentia. We have an anniversary today, Mr. Charles E. and Judy Blakely. Let's wish them happy anniversary in absentia. As Diana prayed for, Willa Martin Bailey, the sister of Jerry Martin, passed last week. We're not really sure what the arrangements are going to be. I'm going to meet with his sister tomorrow, so Aaron goes out. And once I have that information for you, I will pass that on to you as well. Yesterday we said, Friday, we said farewell to one of our loved parishioners, John Long. It was a beautiful service, and one that also hit home for me, because a lot can happen in a year. Offer to God a sacrifice of thanksgiving and make good your vows to the Most High. Thank you. service continues with prayer 8 on page 861 of the Book of Common Prayer.
The Lord be with you. Supper, he took the cup of wine, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Son, the holy food and drink of new and unending life in him.
Sanctify us all so that we may faithfully receive this holy sacrament and serve you in unity, constancy, and peace. And at the last day, bring us with all your saints into the joy of your eternal kingdom. All this we ask for your Son, Jesus Christ, by him and with him and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever.
Amen.
And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done.
Peace to love and serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God.